Alrighty. Let's get this show on the road. So, today is going to be the first of many streams wherein we analyze fights by the Rikishi over the course of the tournament. And this is going to be a new series that I'm also going to be posting to YouTube, so I am going to keep distractions to a minimum. Of course, you know, we will have the chat and we will have, you know, other things going on. But the general idea is I want to be able to watch a fight, be able to break it down step by step, exactly how the person who wins gets their win or how the person who loses got their loss. And we take it from there. The way I'm going to be structuring it is we are going to watch the fight live full time without any commentary. And then we'll watch it at half speed and try to break down piece by piece how it goes. The video that I'm using is made by a dude named Don Don, who put all 15 days up on the YouTubes for us. So that's pretty nice of him to put all of this together. How's everyone doing tonight? We have Nick, Benige, Stream Elements Bot, Safari Guy, Keyman. I'll be doing my best. So for this first fight, it was a very hyped up fight because the last time these two went head to head, it was very close. And this time around, it was the same exact thing. It was a very close fight. It was pretty good back and forth for the entirety of it. But unfortunately, for Kiribayama at least, Terunofuji earns himself the win. You could see right off the bat, well, we should do it at full speed. Right off the bat, Terunofuji gets the forearm underneath the chin and then transitions that into an outside right grip over the right arm. He keeps trying to go for the belt, but Kiribayama does a good job of keeping Terunofuji away from the belt. And this is where Kiribayama tries to get forward, but that's when Terunofuji gets the left inside grip on the belt, and from there, Terunofuji just fights for more and more control over the body. And I think that's truly where he wins the match, because everything after that is just his control. So we could start from the very beginning. No, that's subtitles. I don't need subtitles. What's up, Miku? I haven't seen what. I'm gonna be doing more face cam. I'm gonna need a better shelf. I mean, yeah, I was thinking, I have, on my throne, I have the, bookshelf on it, and I wanted to put it behind me. Anyway. Let me guess, someone bought that off my throne. Maybe I should check that, I'll do that later. First, we gotta get through the sumo, because once again, I'm, gonna be posting this VOD to YouTube. So, like I mentioned earlier, we could see right off of the Tachi eye, the first thing that happens is boom. Oops. You can see the yellow dot I left there, but not what I actually wanted to do. So we see the first thing that happens in this fight. From the very first step, boom. Can it pause, please? I'm sorry, technical difficulties or inability to do anything right. You're going to miss the majority of the stream? Don't worry about it, because it's going to be available on YouTube. So right at the very start, Terunofuji, he puts this inside arm right in front, and that forces Kiribayama to go for this outside right, or this outside left, which, knowing that Terunofuji is just infinitely better at the Yotsuzuma, it's going to be better for him just immediately. The inside right, whether We've seen it in a lot of matches. A lot of guys try to go for the double inside against him, because if he has one inside, he just uses the leverage from that. So he uses that forearm to pop up Kiribayama, and then he immediately wraps it around and gets it under the armpit, and that way Kiribayama, he can't reach the belt from around the back. And what Terunofuji is going to do next is lift the arm up into his armpit so he can't move it anymore after that. And you can see that immediately right there. He misses the grab on the arm. Terunofuji lifts it up into his armpit. And that's something you see a lot in Yotsuzumo, is getting one person's hand to be completely useless by locking it up under the armpit while you try to vie for more leverage underneath. And we could see right down here, it's not a very good angle. You can barely tell what's going on, but they're fighting for dominance on the inside on this right side. And you could see Kiribayama throws his arm underneath to try to get inside, but that's when Terunofuji can attack and grip the outside right. Kiribayama still doesn't have the inside left on the belt yet, so this is really good for Terunofuji. And this is when Kiribayama, you can see him starting to wiggle backwards. He gets back, makes Terunofuji lose his grip on the belt, which, again, is something that you're going to notice a lot of times happening in Yotsuzumo, is wiggling the hips to get the man off of your belt. And now, Kiribayama has a pretty decent position. The only issue is he doesn't have the leverage, nor does he have the grip on the belt. So yeah, it definitely is going to be the reach difference. Terunofuji pushes his hips forward, so now he can get his arms closer to the belt. We could see that Kiribayama has the double inside, this left hand coming up over the back of Kiribayama. But once Terunofuji locks in the grip on the right, which he doesn't, because again, Kiribayama sees it coming, bounces his hips backwards, and now he's getting to the side of Terunofuji, which we haven't really seen an attack be mounted on Terunofuji's side. So that's why Terunofuji, in that moment, you can kind of see it. Well, it jumps back 5 seconds. But you can see very quickly, Kiribayama jumps to the side. Terunofuji immediately drives this left hip forward so he can get recentered shoulder to shoulder up against Kiribayama. Just like that. You can see him drive that right foot forward. He squares his hips, so now he can square his shoulders again. And now, again, he's making this left arm useless from Kiribayama. Kiribayama still trying to wiggle to the side, trying to keep Terunofuji a little off. But now Terunofuji, you can see, he locks his hands down in here. He has the double outside, which is locking Kiribayama into this weird position where he can't really do much. Like, you know how Enho or Uda will try to go underneath, double inside on the belt, but the person is laying on top of them, basically. Now imagine it's Terunofuji laying on top of you, and it's really difficult. You could also tell from this position that Kiribayama's legs are way too far away from the rest of his torso. So if he wanted to try to make this position succeed, he would need to get his legs more underneath him and then be able to try to drive forward using all of the leverage he can build. Or he would have to pull back. Now that he has the double inside, he can try for a pull move. But if he goes for a pull, we see what happens, like with Abi, where he'll just stumble backwards. So what does he opt for here? He tries instead to switch the grip on the right hand, and we could see it probing for the inside, but Terunofuji, quick reflexes, moves to block it. And in the very split second that we get in that angle, you can kind of, well, you can't really see because the body is in the way, but you can see that nobody has a grip on this Kiribayama right side. And you can see the arm is kind of flopping away from Terunofuji. He's just using that forearm to block Kiribayama's space while he recenters himself, replants his feet, And now Terunofuji in a much better position. He has his hips, he has his shoulders square. Kiribayama is at the side and trying to drive at the side so he can turn Terunofuji. But Terunofuji once again actually leans into it. You can see his left hand, his left foot is matching this angle that Kiribayama is making. And Kiribayama is trying to, you know, find something by stepping to the side here. Now Terunofuji goes for a push. He uses his left forearm that we can't really see to push Kiribayama upright. Yeah, that's kind of where his arm is going to be, because you can see the shoulder right there. So he's going to use that forearm to drive Kiribayama up. And now he's trying to go for the inside himself, using his head on the shoulder to create the space he needs, and he does eventually lock in the left on the belt. And this is kind of where I think it's over for Kiribayama, because you never ever want Terunofuji to grab with any kind of inside grip. But Kiribayama tries to fight it off. At first he tries to wrap his forearm around up here to try to break the grip, but then he switches it to the elbow to maybe get his elbow off. And you know, if he tried to put his arm inside like this, then he would lose a little bit of leverage on the outside. So he would have to either try to go for the outside and grip the belt like that, or try to break the grip on his own belt, which both of them are very dangerous. So he doesn't know really what to do, so he's just kind of making a waiting move. Like, he's placing his hand on the elbow to see where the next attack might be. And he does go for the wrist. Immediately, it doesn't work for him. And so he puts his arm back up under the armpit, which is the bad spot to be. I think if he kept his hand on the wrist, it would have been better off for him. Because now Terunofuji, he has the left hand inside. Now he has to fight for the right hand to be in a more favorable position, which he has been fighting for since the very start of the match. That's when Kiribayama loses both of his hands on the body, and that's Terunofuji being able to get an even better grip. One thing to note, too, about Kiribayama's belt is you can kind of tell that it's a little bit loose. He's only grabbing the outside of the belt, which is usually a really good spot for, or rather, it's a good strategy for a sumo wrestler when you go up against someone who is a yotsu specialist. You can see someone like Hokuto Fuji will make his belt a little bit wet, or I think Okinoumi does that, too, or they'll make their belt incredibly loose, so, you know, sometimes the belt will go up to their nipples or something, like, all the way up here. So, making that grip on the belt a little less worth it, unless you really dig in and get both layers. Right now, Terunofuji only has the one. But it doesn't really matter, because that grip is strong, and he actually lost it there. He lost his grip on the belt, but Kiribayama couldn't react fast enough. Terunofuji regains it almost immediately, and now Kiribayama, sensing the danger, tries to drive forward, which only lets Terunofuji hug him even tighter around the back, giving him an even better grip. And you can even tell, too, Kiribayama, it's kind of like a delayed reaction. He felt Terunofuji move his hand, so you could see his foot is pointing to the left this way. His foot is going this way, so he wants to go this way, but his hips are still squared this way, so he's not going to be able to react fast enough. So you can see in this next moment, he tries to go to the side over here, but it's too late. Terunofuji already has a grip on the belt. They do lose if their belt comes undone, but you can make it so that your belt can be loose and not come completely off, you know what I mean? There might be a match where we can see it later, but even here you can kind of see you can see Kiribayama's belly between, you know, the outer layer of the belt and then the lower layer of the belt that's going around his waistline. But here Kiribayama has the right outside on that first layer of belt. That's not really going to help him out at all, because Terunofuji is already locked in the inside left. Kiribayama is trying to do something with his inside left here as well, But again, this is where I think Terunofuji has already won it. Kiribayama actually pulls him forward and goes for a throw over the thigh right here, but that doesn't work out for him because Terunofuji, that right leg is completely planted into the ground, and that's something that we are going to see often in this tournament, is one of Terunofuji's legs is going to be planted, and it's like a friggin' tree trunk. He just does not move. So now Terunofuji goes for the throw himself, trying to trip Kiribayama over his calf, but Kiribayama manages to stumble forward, but because of the follow-through from Terunofuji, he keeps going for the throw afterwards, gets Kiribayama in this position where he can grip the thigh, and then he goes for a throw from there. So this was a really long and a really good Yotsuzumo bout for both of these men. But you can tell that some of the mistakes from Kiribayama were very early on, where his reaction wasn't fast enough, and he either overestimated his own power or underestimated how fucking, like, dude's looking like Hunchback of Notre Dame. Look at this right here. Or he underestimated how difficult it would be to actually move Terunofuji. That is the Komatasukui. Over thigh scooping body drop. Looking like camera-upped, right? So another really well-fought bout from Kiribayama, but if he wants to get the win against Terunofuji, he has to be a little bit more proactive in getting the favorable grip, which is difficult because Terunofuji is fast with his own hands. And even if he does get the favorable grip, Terunofuji is more powerful and can forklift him out if he really wanted to.
Yeah, I'll be like a lion and eat the genitals first. Whoa!
Thank you for the follow, Pipe Fonseca. Up next, we have Terunofuji versus Daieisho, and I'm going to take a drink of water real quick. And here, now I'll check my throne. Damn. Who's buying me a fucking bookcase? One second.
See, Safari guy bought us a bookcase.
Safari guy bought us a bookcase? Thank you.
Bear, I'm accidentally gonna run you over with my chair. He's right here. Look at him.
Bear.
Alrighty. Day 2, Terunofuji and Daieisho. This was also another common theme that I kept up during the tournament, that Daieisho came very close to beating Terunofuji because of the good yotsu, or the good oshizumo, the thrusting, right to his face and neck. And you could see, almost immediately, Daieisho keeping him away from the belt, making sure he is always at an arm's length. Terunofuji not being able to make too much headway. He's not really in full control at any moment, not even at the end here, until he manages to fight his way back into the ring and get the win. So like I said, early on you can kind of see Daieisho is pretty much in full control the entire way. Right off the tachi eye, distance is made and distance is maintained. Daieisho getting that second thrust with the left arm right up here in the shoulder of Terunofuji, keeping his arm too far away from anything really, can't even grip underneath the arm. Distance maintained. Thrust to the face, Terunofuji trying to shrug it off by raising his left shoulder to try to create a bit of resistance. But that's when Daieisho, and you can see this with most Oshizumo, in this entire line coming right up from his feet all the way up through his back. He is leaning forward. He is driving those legs forward, and you'll see him. Like, these knees are pumping, the knees are bent so he can keep creating leverage, and that's exactly what you need to do if you want to push someone back. The only problem is they're trying to push a tree off of its roots. Which eventually does work, because Terunofuji, sliding backwards a little bit, Daieisho still at the neck, pushing at the neck, which is a good weak spot. He loses the grip on the face, and this is where, okay, now Terunofuji can have a little bit of control. He has the outside right on the arm, and if Daieisho can't make any space, then this is where Terunofuji can win it. But Daieisho slips out of the grip, and, I mean, right here, he almost slipped forward completely. Terunofuji keeps catching him, and this is where Daieisho, again, creates separation. Terunofuji kind of stumbles forward right there because he was trying to maintain a grip on the body. But Daieisho leaps backwards, and again, you can see Daieisho's legs bent, driving. He wants to go forward again, but he's getting pushed back by Terunofuji, who's stumbling forward. So what does he do next? He goes for another step back. Terunofuji still walking forward. And again, just really good distance making. Going at the face, driving the legs forward. Terunofuji withstanding the attack by putting his head down and putting a vulnerable spot of his in danger. And right here, right around the back. The Gyoji sounds silly at this speed. And see, after this, creates the distance again. Terunofuji stumbles forward, and Daieisho gets the hand around and to the side, because now he hops to the side again. Instead of hopping back, he hops to the side, gets the arm up in a really bad position, and now he can dive under the armpit and get to the side of Terunofuji, which is exactly what he does. He grips around the belt, but Terunofuji blocking with this huge bicep and this forearm. So now, like, if Daieisho could get his head into the armpit or, like, underneath the armpit, like, if Daieisho had his head right here instead, then that's 100% the win. There's no way Terunofuji can come back from that. But because Daieisho didn't have his head on the back and he couldn't drive Terunofuji off position, this lets Terunofuji kind of survive, because you could see his leg is planted. This left leg is eventually going to get driven back, but he has enough stability just on this back leg that he can maintain himself a little bit. Thank you for the follow, Maras Mies. And right now, again, Daieisho driving forward, leaning forward. Terunofuji, that one leg on the Tawada, it's not even on the Tawada, you can kind of barely see, it's not touching the Tawada, so he has like an inch before he really gets a little bit more, but that knee bent, that back leg, maintaining the balance of his entire body, like, that's just a lot of leg strength. And if you've seen, that's a video of him like doing the one ton leg presses. Yeah, this man has some strong legs. Again, right here, if Daieisho had his head in or on the other side of the armpit, he could just drive forward and knock Terunofuji back. But Terunofuji, now his foot is on the Tawada. Yeah, sumo's really dope. Now his foot is on the Tawada. This allows him to get a little bit more leverage underneath his own body. And he can recenter his hips, he can recenter his shoulders. Now, instead of being driven at from the side, he's being driven at from, like, the mass of his body. This is where he can catch someone. And this is where Daieisho, I'm not sure if he slips, we can catch this again. Just keep watching his legs, they're driving forward. Just, you know, you learn this as a running back in football. You drive those knees up, you push, you pump the legs. And that's where he stumbles forward. You can kind of catch it right there. Watch this left foot down here. He's going to step and then stumble. And that's where, that's the one fatal mistake he makes. He has his leg planted. And instead of driving it, he goes up on his tippy toes to try to force it out with like the upper part of his chest to Terunofuji's. And he stumbles forward, and that gives Terunofuji enough way to step backwards and away from the attack, recenter himself in the ring, and then uses Daisho's own momentum against him, because after he stumbles, he tries to correct himself by going back up this way, but then Terunofuji says, oh, you want to go that way? I'll just keep sending you that way. And that's all there is to it. If Daisho does not stumble and instead continue, if he doesn't go up on his tippy toes, he wins that. If he doesn't try to tippy toe and instead keeps pumping the legs, he could definitely win that. Wakatakakage, the third bout of the tournament. What are some accidents that can happen? An accident, if you mean by like accidentally losing, which that is something that can happen, you can accidentally lose the match by either stepping out of bounds or slipping and falling. If you mean like physical accidents, like injuries, mostly it's joints or extremities or maybe a broken rib or a bloody nose. Other accidents include bowling over the gyoji, like being thrown into the referee here and accidentally knocking him over, which can be funny sometimes, but you have to remember they're like old ass men that will fall over if the wind blows. Third match of the tournament was Terunofuji, Wakatakakage. Wakatakakage does the same thing at first, keeping the distance. But instead of trying to go for an attack, he tries to go for a pull, and he just gets pushed out. This is not a very complicated match, and it's mostly Terunofuji kind of standing there and taking an attack than anything else. Crowd bowling. Yeah, it happens more often than you think. Yeah, you can see Wakatakakage, again, immediately feels that hand inside, probing for his belt, so he takes a hop backwards. Terunofuji on the attack, but he's not really committed to a full attack because he doesn't want to overcommit and then have Wakatakakage sidestep. So you can see he's pretty cautious here in the middle of the ring, kind of just waiting to see what Wakatakakage will do, which is going to be Wakatakakage getting a little bit overzealous. You can see puts both of the hands on the boobies. I don't exactly know what he's going to go for from here, because you need to have your hand on the belt, or at least like both arms up in the armpits to start trying to drive forward. But he goes for the hands at the boobs, and from there, Terunofuji simply says, hey, don't touch my boobs, that's sexual harassment. And Wakatakakage says, oh, okay, I'm sorry. So he lifts his hand from the boob, and now, again, they're staring each other down. Terunofuji playing some really good defensive sumo here, while Wakatakakage doesn't really know how to mount an attack. So he goes charging in again, trying to get arms under the armpit or something. I honestly don't know what Wakatakakage was going for. But Terunofuji counters by getting in closer, which forces Wakatakakage to jump away, and seeing that he doesn't really have much room to jump away anywhere else, Terunofuji pursues and pushes him out of the ring. Not too complicated of a match. Frontal push out, that's one you'll see a lot. Day 4, against Onosho. Onosho, another Oshizumo, kind of falls the same way as Daieisho, Meisei, Takanosho. See, once again, creating separation, Onosho trying to keep Terunofuji at a distance, but once he gets the double inside, Terunofuji has the double outside armbreaker hold, and even though it looks like Onosho is in control, Terunofuji is just, he's too big to be moved. And that's something that is another common thing that happens. They get double inside up underneath the armpits and they try to drive Terunofuji forward, but Terunofuji just says, no, you can't do that. I won't let you. So once again, like I said, Oshizumo versus Terunofuji. You have to go for the throat, you have to go for the face, you have to go for that upper chest. And that's exactly what Onosho does. He has a good hand right here on the neck of Terunofuji. Terunofuji, his arms aren't doing anything right now. Onosho charges again with his head. He uses both of his arms to, like, create distance again, but now he doesn't have, like, the 1-2-1-2 follow-up. He went for, like, you know, the Takakeisho, both arms go, which... that's not a good rhythm to have, because when you come in again, Terunofuji has the possibility of catching you. And that's exactly what almost happens here, is Onosho charges again, and it's not a very well-calculated charge, too, because he's getting the side, and I can't see where his right hand is, but you see Terunofuji, his hand is almost on the belt right here, which... instead of going for the belt, he pulls up his arm to slap Onosho's hands away. And Onosho follows up with another charge of his head, once again to create distance. And that's where he does get a 1-2 punch really quick. His face. But Terunofuji just drives forward again. Onosho, he's thrusting, but he's not really doing much with it. Terunofuji tries to grab underneath the arms, but misses. Onosho getting real low, like this weird frog stance over here. And this is where Onosho gets the double inside once again. And I think that's because it's more because Terunofuji wanted it than Onosho wanting it. Because Terunofuji locks in the hand around the arm, the other hand around the arm. And you can see he's pulling him in. Like, he's not letting those hands go. He locks in this arm breaker hold. He's not letting these arms go. He does not want Onosho to create separation again. So now, Onosho is trying to wrestle himself away from Terunofuji, but Terunofuji doubles down, really locks in the grip around the biceps instead of just the forearms. And now Onosho just gets tossed to the side like the sack of potatoes he is. Terunofuji kind of lessens the grip with his left hand. Catches Onosho again, who I think at this point Onosho thought he had nothing to do but try to drive through him with that double inside up underneath the armpits, but right there was a pretty decent missed opportunity. We can see that again. Terunofuji nearly loses the grip here, so I think if Onosho wanted to, he could have pushed away and then tried to retreat to the side to create that space again so he could go for another, you know, follow-up charge. But he opts into the push instead, which is going to be his undoing because, again, Terunofuji, that back leg, knees bent, driving forward, getting the win. Next match against Takanosho. Takanosho was really close to winning as well. Takanosho creating distance, but this time he's not really going for his usual Oshizumo. He's actually trying to go for the push forward, and he can maintain against him. But Terunofuji, I mean, if he has any kind of grip, it's just going to be his win. So usually what Takanosho did the last time they met was the same thing we saw with Daieisho, was just drive at the neck and the face. But this time Takanosho opted for a little more balanced approach. He went for the initial charge. He went for the push, but then... it might just be because he gets caught like this. You can see Terunofuji, actually misses the grip on the belt there, but Takanosho has the inside right up and under, kind of in a position where his shoulder is up underneath Terunofuji's armpit, so now Terunofuji's arm kind of reaching out into nowhere. So I think this is where Takanosho thinks to himself, okay, I have to try to take advantage of this, resets it, and now, even though Terunofuji's arm is inside, it's in an awkward position as well. So Takanosho really driving that right arm up underneath Terunofuji, goes for a push forward, and it kind of looked like Terunofuji catches him here. But it might also be Takakeisho really driving that right arm up, that right shoulder up. And you can see that because of the way Terunofuji is gripping the arm, it nearly knocks him off balance. But once again, back leg planted in the dirt. This man has tree trunk legs. He is not going to be felled that easily unless you bring an axe. He hops on it. And now after settling his left foot, hops around on his right foot while Takanosho actually tries to pull him around with that arm he has. So instead of Terunofuji dictating what happens with that arm, Takanosho says, okay, if you're going to put me in this position, I'm going to use this arm to my advantage. And so he twists his shoulder up to get Terunofuji to lean over, which throws him off balance. Which works for a little while. And then Takanosho, I mean, if your shoulders are square and your hips are square against Terunofuji's square shoulder and hips, you're just not going to win the push. Nobody can. Except maybe Hakuho. So now Takanosho going for another pull, but it's a little too late at this point because Terunofuji is just way too close. That arm now is in a weird position for Takanosho, who could have gone for a throw right here. He gets himself into a position. He puts his hips forward, trying to get his thigh in front of Terunofuji's leg, but he doesn't get his leg inside Terunofuji's there. And you could see while Takanosho is twisting around, that is what he went for, but Terunofuji wasn't caught by it. And then Terunofuji throws instead. Going into stalk mode. Thank you, Poetic Wine. So Terunofuji just gets the pretty good throwdown. It's five different winning techniques in 5 days. His next match against Okinoumi. Oh. Okinoumi, a Yotsu specialist, tries to get the double inside against Terunofuji. Terunofuji trying to grab the belt or keep the arm breaker hold. He can't decide which. He's going for the outside right on the belt. But even just chest to chest, he's pushing back Okinoumi. And then once he does get the grip on the belt, you could see, like I said earlier, the belt grip is really loose. But it's enough. It's enough for Terunofuji at the very least. So to start off this match, we see Okinoumi. He goes for the inside left immediately. He put his forearm inside, like close to his chest, so then he can twist out Terunofuji's right arm. And right here, Terunofuji wiggles back his hips away. He wiggles his hips backwards, so Okinoumi can't get the grip on the belt. While Okinoumi doesn't even try to do the same, but instead he tries to drive forward so he can get the grip on the belt. After this is where we see Terunofuji kind of debate with himself. Do I want to raise the arm up into my armpit, or do I want to go for the grip on the belt? And he opts for the grip on the belt, probably because he feels that his grip is just going to be stronger. So we can't really tell what's going on the right side, but Okinoumi does not have any kind of grip on that right side. He's just driving forward chest to chest. And then Okinoumi actually opts to put his head to the right, probably to try to get more force over there. And that's probably one of the mistakes he made. Instead of keeping his head on this left side, and like if he had his head over here, he could lean his shoulder a bit more forward to try to get the grip on the belt. But because he goes for the head over on the right side, he's trying to get the grip on the belt on the right side, which, I mean, I think he should have kept on doing what he was doing. Because he was making a little bit more leeway over here with this inside left. And I think if he gets the inside left, it's more dangerous for Terunofuji. But then you can see, switches his head to the right. And now he has nothing doing on the right side. We just saw his right hand dangling. So now his right hand is over here, like, you know, doing nothing. And it's like, bro, what are you doing? What are you going to do with that right hand down to the side doing nothing? Terunofuji's right is right here, his left right here, and right after that we'll see Terunofuji go for the belt with the outside left while blocking, or with the outside right while blocking with the inside left. You can see the inside left, I think, was actually on the belt as he goes for the outside right here. And you can see Okinoumi pulling backwards, probably because Terunofuji has a grip on the belt and is trying to get him to loosen it. So instead of going, you know, chest to chest, belly to belly to drive that inside left onto the belt and kind of trade inside left, outside right, Okinoumi instead opts to try to pull away to try to loosen the grip on his own belt, because he still does have a kind of favorable position on this left side. It's just he's given up too much on this right side. You can see Terunofuji still missing the grip on the outside right, but he's not giving up the inside left either. And that's because Okinoumi, in avoiding this outside left, you can see how far back his leg is, which means his hip has to be further back, which means the rest of his left side can't reach as far. So because he's trying so hard to avoid that grip, he himself also can't go for the grip. Thank you for the follow, Batosai72. Like 72. Eat the genitals first. Whoa. What? And now Okinoumi does center up a little bit. He squares his hips forward, and Terunofuji again, looking like a little hunchback over here, like, meh. Look at him. And then you can see, instead of going for like a far outside grip, like on the side, he's trying to get the inside grip in front of the belt, like right where we can't see it. Instead of coming all the way back around, he's going straight for the belt, like through the arm of Okinoumi, which if he can get that, then this left arm is going to be completely useless for Okinoumi because it's going to be too far inside, too scrunched inside. And so still, chest to chest, Terunofuji getting the better push until finally gets the grip on the belt, just like I said. And now this inside left from Okinoumi, completely useless because he's grabbing skin over here. And this is kind of where Okinoumi gives it up because he's driving his feet and he's like, yep, okay, I'm done, I guess. Who's the old guy in the crowd with the purple? I don't know. Could be anybody. Oh, do you mean this old guy in the crowd? That is one of the other referees. I don't see any other old guys in the crowd wearing purple. Yeah, even in a short Yotsu battle like that, a lot of small things happening that you might not see. Going up against Myogiryu on day 7, the biggest loser of the tournament. Myogiryu going for the inside left, similar. Actually has the double inside until Terunofuji pulls his left side back and gets the throw. So this match, once again, double inside up underneath the armpits. And instead of pushing forward, Terunofuji this time opts for a step back. So you can see, double inside, they can't grab the belt. Myogiryu simply cannot grab the belt because arm breaker hold. Keeps the arm up in the armpits, can't grab the belt because you don't have, you know, Mr. Fantastic arms. Arm breaker hold on this outside. Myogiryu, I can't really tell what's going on this right side, but it's a little bit similar, except he has his elbow back a little bit. So, like, over here, you can see his entire arm is being consumed by Bicep no Fuji, whereas over here, he still has his elbow out, so he can possibly pull that elbow out if he really wanted to, and then try to re-attack with that right arm. Or if you wanted to drive forward with it, he would have to, like, slip it in. But Terunofuji's grip, you can't really tell from here because it's through the body. But Terunofuji's grip is only on the forearm, whereas over here on the left side, it's on the bicep. So he has a much stronger grip on the left here. And this is how he decides. I'm going to put my left foot or my right foot forward. I'm going to drive or drop my left foot back. And then I'm going to go for the throw because he knows his strong grip is on this right arm. And so it's a very easy decision for him to make. He doesn't have a strong grip on his left side. So he pulls the left side back and goes for a throw, committing it entirely to his right. And you can even see, I was a little too far back. You can even see he pulls his left arm away and then locks it with his right here. See, you can see that it's locked. So Myogiryu, who never had any control with this left arm breaker held, thrown from underneath his armpit, not really much he can do. Oh, if you're talking about the other old guy in the audience, he is the bow spinner. So, like, this old guy right here. At the end of the sumo matches every day, there's a guy that comes out and does a bow twirling ceremony. And that's him. He twirls the bow. Now, this match, Terunofuji versus Endo on day 8. Endo creating distance, but then Terunofuji catches up to him and gets an easy push out. Again, another very simple, not very complicated match. Endo, much like the other Oshi Zumo wrestlers, creates some space for himself by going for, you know, hands to the chest, hand to the neck, and then dives forward head first into the chest, but Terunofuji blocks with that shoulder, and Terunofuji, I mean, he has the right hand right up in the rib cage of Endo. Endo really can't do anything, so he tries to step backwards and away from the attack, but it's just simply nothing doing. Terunofuji is the Yokozuna. Unless you mean his opponents, in which case, a lot of his opponents are not very good. Terunofuji and Takayasu, who, I mean, he was 5-3, but had a terrible collapse afterwards, did not finish the tournament well. This is two Yotsuzumo specialists again. And you can see, I think Terunofuji's specialty is that outside right for that arm breaker hold. But here, it's actually on the belt. You can see early on, Takayasu tried to pull with that left inside arm, but, I mean, you can't pull a tree, you can't push a tree. What can you do to Terunofuji? Terunofuji walks it forward, has the inside left, and gets the Yorikiri with simply overwhelming power. So you can see it here, once again. Inside left, outside right, and you could see it was only for like a split second, but you could see right here, Terunofuji's inside left on the belly. On the belly right there. And that means he's going for the belt, which Takayasu also wants the inside left on the belt. So he commits to it. He says, okay, I'll give that up. And we'll trade inside left. But now Terunofuji is just in a much, much, much better position. He has inside left, outside right. Takayasu, you can see him wiggle that hip to try to, I don't know if he was going for a throw. He does it again here. He's definitely not going for a throw. I think he's trying to wiggle Terunofuji's right arm off of his own belt. But it's just locked in. Takayasu, you can see he's fighting at Terunofuji's arm. The left arm that we can't see through the body. But you can rest assured, Terunofuji's right hand is on the belt, gripping it like an iron fist. Ooh. And Takayasu is trying to be like, no, don't do that. No. But, I mean, how are you realistically going to make the Yokozuna lessen his grip? And then from here, it's as simple as ABC, 1, 2, 3. You put one foot in front of the other. Terunofuji, all he has to do is start walking forward. And that's what he's going to do in a couple of seconds. It sounds really funny at half speed. Takayasu, I think it was actually Takayasu starting off going for a pull. Don't do that to me. I think the sequence started with Takayasu going for a pull. Like, actually, no, that was just Terunofuji standing up and walking forward. Never mind. I thought there would have been a little more to it, but Terunofuji just walks it forward. Takayasu tries to rock him off balance by rocking himself off balance, but, I mean, there was nothing you could do at that point, my man. You were dead way before that point. And that is the Yorikiri for Terunofuji. Up against Nephew on day 10. Because apparently we can't write Hoshoryu in the Twitch predictions. Goes for the outside left, which turns into an inside left for Hoshoryu, and double arm breaker hold for Terunofuji again. Hoshoryu puts up a really good fight, but Terunofuji just exercises full control. Again, it's just really easy for him from this position. And you can see right off the tachi eye. Come on, let me pause it. This is exactly where Hoshoryu wants to be. This was a very planned attack. He steps to the side and he goes for the outside grip on the belt. This was 100% planned because we've seen the first, 9 days of the tournament, this outside right from Terunofuji is deadly. So how does Hoshoryu attack from here? Well, Terunofuji just goes whoop and grabs the outside right. How tall is he? That is a good question. How tall is Terunofuji? He is 191 centimeters tall. But yeah, he goes right outside. He just, takes a half step back, outside right on the arm, and Hoshoryu is just in major trouble from here. You can see he's fighting for the inside right as well, but Terunofuji gets his arm breaker grip on that arm before it can grab the belt. So now the only thing Hoshoryu has going for him is the fact that his inside left is on the belt and not up in the armpit, completely useless. And then that's exactly where his arm goes afterwards, which once again, Terunofuji walks forward, knees bent like he's, Brian Shaw lifting the Atlas stones. lifts Hoshoryu up off the clay. Hoshoryu, he does his damnedest to fight back. He tries to throw his leg in there to either trip or throw Terunofuji off balance, but it only serves to cause him to stumble backwards. And then Terunofuji, I mean, if he wasn't going to break Horshoryu's legs and just lean over on him, that's how he was going to do it with the push out. What's up, Mitsuno? So another quick and dirty win for Terunofuji. Who is Terunofuji? Up against good buddy Ichinojo. This is actually a long bout. Ichinojo going for the outside left and actually maintains it. Going for a good push. And like I mentioned earlier, Terunofuji does not have that favored outside right. So Ichinojo in more control with that outside left, but it's not a very tight grip. You can see it's not locked in on all layers of the belt. And then this is where they stalemate for a little bit, chest to chest. Ichinojo going for a push against the Yokozuna. Inside right is also not locked in really deep. That's where Ichinojo lost his grip on the belt both ways. And then from there, it's all Terunofuji. So this was, again, really, really good Yotsuzumo. And probably, if you're going to be Yotsuzumo, going to be your avenue to defeat Terunofuji. So watch this. Once again, outside left. Except, Terunofuji doesn't immediately go for the outside right around the bicep here. Because we've seen it before where he goes for the inside left and then will be like, nope, I'm going to pop this back out and go for the outside right. But Ichinojo is not like the rest of them. Going to finish a report. Do your homework, my man. Ichinojo actually used his arm to block Terunofuji from doing anything with his inside right, and then he returned to the belt. So in that really little bit of time, we can see Ichinojo, come on, he goes from a hand on the belt, misses the hand on the belt, and because he knows he missed it, he blocks Terunofuji from doing anything with that right hand. So he slaps. Oh, nothing doing over here. Got a block. And then immediately after the block, goes back to the belt to basically guarantee that this right arm is where he wants it to be. And he locks it in on the belt, and we could see over here, Terunofuji doing the same thing he likes to do. Left hand up, right arm up in the armpit. Right arm is not doing anything for anyone. And most importantly, I mentioned it earlier, how Okinoumi switched his head from, you know, the left side to the right side to try to get some momentum on this right shoulder to drive it forward. Ichinojo does not do that. Ichinojo keeps his head on the left side, knowing that this is uncomfortable for Terunofuji. Inside right and outside left that is up in the air, Terunofuji cannot throw Ichinojo the same way he can throw other people. So Ichinojo does a really good job of actually being able to... Now he's driving forward. Terunofuji tries to counter with a throw, and it's not going to be any kind of kill shot, but it's enough to get Ichinojo off balance with that inside right. And that is, you know, that is the risk that you give up when you give up the inside right to the Yokozuna. He has a little bit more leverage on that right side. But Ichinojo manages to block and maintain. They both recenter. And now, Terunofuji's left hand is hanging. He tries to get for the belt. We could barely see in that little flap of time that Ichinojo, pop, he's slapping for the belt in the back as well. So he's trying to get the inside right on the belt. Either that or he's giving his friend a good smack on the ass. But once again, Ichinojo, this is in a position that he curated for himself. This is exactly where he wants to be. And he hops up again. He pushes his hips forward so he can drive that right shoulder. And again, once again, the placement of the head, very important. Instead of switching his head from over here around to over here, he keeps his head up on the left side. And he drives Terunofuji down with his head. Thank you for the follow, Sickobino. Good form, bud. So instead of switching the position of your head so you can get a little bit more leverage with your shoulder, he's instead driving his head down into Terunofuji and, you know, gaining his leverage that way. Thank you for the host, Sickobino. And off of that, he gets the inside right on the belt. Terunofuji actually loses his grip on the belt right here. Ichinojo in full control. But Terunofuji once again trying to counter with a throw at the edge. And Ichinojo doesn't fully commit to the push because he knows he might fall out because, you know, he's a big boy. That gives Terunofuji enough time to re-lock the grip on the belt. And once again, you can see Terunofuji is trying to do that, where he's switching what side his head is on. Which, Anja, I didn't think that was that important until I actually started watching these matches really slowly. You can see right here, Terunofuji is going to try to move his head from this side to this side so he can drive further with that right shoulder, get it forward, lock it in on both layers of the belt, but Ichinojo blocks it with his own head. He leans down with it so he can maintain grip on the outside right, and he doesn't let Terunofuji switch it. And now they're locked into this stalemate for a little while. Terunofuji did set out he did achieve what he set out for, which was a really good grip on that inside right around the back. And Ichinojo's grip, if it were on, all of the layers of the belt, it would have been much more stable for him. And he would have been able to drive forward again with it. And he does. But again, Terunofuji, that outside left, manages to throw Ichinojo off balance, and that's what he does the entire match through. Anytime Ichinojo starts driving, that's when Terunofuji throws him any way he can to get him off balance. And now, Terunofuji drives, and I don't really know exactly what happens in this moment to make Ichinojo lose the grip on the belt, but Terunofuji pops Ichinojo up. He probably lost the left-hand grip on the belt when Terunofuji wiggled back a bit. Like, we could see it here. Like, at this point, Terunofuji probably got Ichinojo to lose the grip on the outside left because we could see how his arm is coming down here and not, you know, going that way. So at this point, Ichinojo has lost his grip on the outside left. This is where Terunofuji attacks. And this is where Ichinojo goes to throw him, which is why he lets go of the inside right on the belt, which causes him to get thrown in this direction, and now he's in a really bad spot, but he does the spin move, maintains. I think right here, there was an opportunity for Ichinojo. I can pause it again. You can see after he turns around, this right foot, he needed to take he needed to either keep it here or he needed to get a little bit more leverage with it, taking a step back so he wouldn't get pushed off and forced back up into an upright position, because you can see he's going to get pushed up this way. So if he had that right leg a little far back, he could continue to lean forward and not get pushed up. And I know those lines are a little crossing over each other, but you get what I'm saying. Because you can see he gets pushed back, stood up, and then this is where Terunofuji, inside right, attacks Ichinojo, struggling from this point. Now he's trying to use that left leg as a bit of leverage, head to head, shoulder to shoulder, and Terunofuji going for the, you know, what he won with on day one, the over-thigh scooping body drop. Ichinojo just being pushed from the side, which is... this is what I said about Daieisho on day two. Because the head is right up in the armpit, you know, he's getting a good whiff, he can drive his shoulder harder through the body and out of the ring. That's giving him a lot more pressure on a thin side of the body where, you know, the pressure is not going to be able to be spread out across the wide side of the body. And that's how Ichinojo eventually gets pushed out of the ring. So, like, that was incredible sumo from Ichinojo. That was insanely good sumo from Ichinojo. Here we have Meisei, the Seki Wacky. Meisei, like all the other Oshi, tried to create distance with the push to the neck, and then opts for the inside left underneath the armpit of Terunofuji, which is exactly where you don't want to be, and then Terunofuji gets the leg throw. So thankfully, another short bout for us. We can see, like I mentioned, all Oshi Zumo wrestlers go for the Tachi Eye, push straight to the throat, thumb up in the neck, and then he opts for inside left. And that's where he dies. Because you can even see, Terunofuji, he's pulling on the bicep here. He doesn't want the distance to be created from the push, so he's grabbing this and he's pulling it back. He's pulling the arm back towards him. And then he gets exactly what he wants, the outside arm breaker hold. He has the inside left on the belt too, so now Meisei is just trying to drive forward with his legs, pushing forward. He gets lifted up, which allows Terunofuji to place him back down however he likes while he re-centers himself, he re-stabilizes his legs into the ground. And then Meisei continues on the push afterwards, thinking that he's got his man reeling, which... he really doesn't, because we could see wide stance. This leg is back, so it's, you know, pushing up, forward, and into us. And then, again, wide around the arm. He has the inside left. So this is everything Terunofuji wants to have in a fight. And then a really quick move here. I'm not sure if this was Meisei trying to get to his side or Terunofuji. With that right hand kind of manipulating how he wanted him to move. But either way, Meisei goes to the side to try to attack from the side. And this is when Terunofuji once again uses momentum against his opponent. We're going to see it in just a moment. Places the leg in between his opponent's legs. And Meisei... jumping forward into the attack. He tried to wrap his leg as well, but by that point it was already too late. Like Meisei was pushing, and wrapped his leg around Terunofuji's, and he himself got thrown. So, not a very good idea from Meisei there. Not very well fought. So far I would say the best bout was against Ichinojo. Up then was Sekiwake Mitakeumi. Mitakeumi not able to play to his own game plan. And another outside right easy win for Terunofuji. I feel like I don't even need to break this down. Mitakeumi. I mentioned this a lot throughout the basho, but Mitakeumi is pretty good at the balanced sumo. He can do both yotsu and oshi. I prefer his oshi style, and he is slightly better at that. But we could see Terunofuji denies the creation of distance by locking in both of his hands right underneath here. You can see locks in his hands underneath the arms of Mitakeumi, who's really locked up in there now. And that was one of the fastest locks that Terunofuji got. And from there, even though the lock was broken, Mitakeumi did not create any kind of distance. So on the second effort, Terunofuji simply leans forward and grabs the belt. That was a really smart move from Terunofuji, kind of how, like, you know, Hakuho charges with his shoulder first. He goes like this to catch the push. So Terunofuji stands up, does this to catch the push. Like, he does that double bicep flex or something. Catches the push. And if they can't create distance, he goes for the belt like this. If they do create distance, he tries to lock in that right arm under the armpit. And because he got the grip on the belt, Mitakeumi couldn't do anything. Simple as. I appreciate that, Shinobi. If you missed any of it, you can catch it on my YouTube channel where I will be posting it later today. Which apparently is not something you're allowed to do, because as a person who is affiliate on Twitch, you're supposed to wait 24 hours to post it to YouTube, but I don't really care about that. This was the biggest match of the tournament. Terunofuji versus Abi, and we all know how this one goes. Abi does create distance with the Oshi, gets his man on the edge, but then after he can't finish, he goes for a pull and a katasukashi, which doesn't work because Terunofuji is not someone you can pull down. So back to the beginning of this bout. Once again, as most Oshi Zumo wrestlers do, goes straight for the throat, and we can see, again, Terunofuji goes underneath the arms to try to stop it, but Abi goes higher. Abi goes straight for the neck, he goes straight for the face, he doesn't screw around with the chest, and look at how far forward Abi is leaning here. And look at the way he's driving his legs. Like, again, that's what they teach you in, you know, football and rugby, and hopefully in sumo as well. You keep pumping the knees, you keep driving these legs forward, you keep generating as much force as possible. And look at how far forward Abi is. And he is not worried about falling forward because he is driving forward. He charges again. His leg is in a bit of an awkward position here that causes him to have to swing his hip wide and then replant that left foot. But we can even see, after this push, Terunofuji tries to grab the outside right and can't because Abi, he wasn't going for the face that time. He went for the bicep. He slapped the arm back, and now he has a lot of distance so he can recharge again. Now he's swung that hip around. He's recentered. His eye is, you know, on the tiger, and he charges forward again, this time, once again, going straight for the neck. And we can see Terunofuji's counter to these thrusts is to try to get up underneath them and slap the arms up so he can go for the belt afterwards. But it's just not working here. Abi, still going for the neck, now pushing forward, still at the neck, under the armpit. He has Terunofuji pretty much dead to rights here, but Terunofuji grabs the bicep here. He gets up underneath the arm here. This was like the last position Terunofuji wanted to be in and the last position he could have possibly won from. And this is where he does it, because this is where he gets up underneath the arms. He doesn't let Abi go for the 1-2 follow-up because he captures this right arm underneath his armpit, under the bicep. He swings it back, goes for the throw. And you can see that right leg is planted back there. His right leg, or his left leg, planted in the ground on the Tawada. He is not moving backwards. And now, with that risky move at the edge, he restabilizes. He's going to replant that foot. And Abi knowing that he can't force out Terunofuji from this angle because he's going to replant the foot, recenter, Abi takes the step back and goes for the slap down. But like many analysts have pointed out, as he's going for the step backwards, Terunofuji, just watch this foot. Watch that foot. It's not moving. Terunofuji simply does not move as he's being pulled. So Abi, instead of pulling him, he just kind of throws himself backwards. And because of that, he slips. And he's, caught staring up into the starlight as his soul fades away from his body. And as Terunofuji walks away with the Yusho, he looks like a turtle on his back. Yeah, it was just... if there were two moments or three moments that Terunofuji could have lost, it would have been against Abi at the edge there. It would have been against Daieisho at the edge. And it would have been against Ichinojo. And then, of course, day 15, when nothing mattered because Terunofuji has already won the Yusho, we still have to watch him versus Takakeisho. Takakeisho gets caught, tries for the recharge, goes for the recharge again, actually sent to Terunofuji spiraling backwards, staring each other down now. Really gingerly on that attack after the stare down. Really couldn't do much of anything. He'll get it next year. Origin. I'm sure he will. Yeah, we could see in this match. I've said it however many times so far this video. Oshizumo has to create distance and they need to keep attacking the neck if they want to topple Terunofuji. But Takakeisho, I mean, he gets caught at first. He just simply got caught off the tachi eye, like Terunofuji likes to do. Arm right underneath the bicep, hand on the belt. So Takakeisho has to spend his tachi eye recentering himself. He goes to slap down the arms of Terunofuji and then recharge for the neck. But his arms are not nearly as long as someone like Abi's, where... you know, he can keep following up this attack where he can go boom, 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 boom. Takakeisho, I mean, there's a reason why they call him the battle hamster. He's easily caught once again by Terunofuji and has to create some distance again, which he does. Goes for the slap down on the arms that weren't even there, but uses the momentum coming back up. So it's he goes down with the arms and then comes back up with even more force to push forward in and through Terunofuji, which actually sent Terunofuji all the way back almost to the edge. Takakeisho was really slow on his approach because he's been burned before, you know. Takakeisho, if he charges too far forward, they just step out of the way, which is why he was very cautious on his approach. Which, if Takakeisho wanted to win this match, he needed to go all out, but he was way too timid and way too cautious on the match. So now Terunofuji catches him again, can recenter himself. Takakeisho tries to create distance, creates distance as the Oshizumo wrestler should, stares his opponent down, and then watch how baby this is. He hops forward and then he just kind of like blah, 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 blah. Like, it's so dumb. Watch, like, we can watch this at full speed too and it's just as slow. Can I pause the video, please? Holy crap. Yeah, we can watch this at normal speed and it's just as slow. Like, what was that? You trying to lean in and give him a kiss? What the? And then from there, Takakeisho just gets caught. He can't create the distance he needs. And even when he does, he's way too sluggish. He slaps Terunofuji to the side, but his follow-up is, again, too gentle. And Terunofuji just drives forward for the win. And that is what gives Terunofuji his first Zensho Yusho. Overall, a very incredible tournament for Terunofuji. Semi-decoy? I mean, I guess he kind of tried to fake out, but at the same time, I don't really know what that could have accomplished. Like, if we go back to it again, like, he stands up, he hops forward, Terunofuji doesn't fall for it, and then he just leans forward and goes for another push to the chest. Which is so unlike Takakeisho. It's so unlike him because he's usually just charged forward. And I know that Takakeisho tried to overcompensate for that this match by not charging forward so recklessly, but it just made him look kind of ridiculous in this match. I mean, let's be real, I'm kind of a noob on sumo too. I just watch it too much. How would you classify a noob? Because I've only been watching for like 2 years. Yeah, I do see what you're saying though. He could have tried to make, like, he's trying to bluff something. He hops to try to make Terunofuji do something, but then Terunofuji just doesn't do anything. So it makes him look like an idiot, you know? And then follow-up throughout the match was just not good. So, again, the closest matches we had were, that literally comes down to Daieisho's foot slip right here. Watch it. Slip! Or stumble, rather. If Daieisho doesn't stumble and instead keeps driving his legs, he wins. The next match that was really close. Where are you? Ichinojo. Ichinojo in full control up until the moment where he's not, where he loses the outside left grip, which was really good by Terunofuji to escape from. And then this last match against Abi, which was very exciting. Like, if anything, this really showed that Abi is still at least, like, Komusubi level. Which, we will be seeing. This coming Sunday, I will be doing the Guess the Banzuke game here on Twitch. It will be at 10 Central Standard Time, or perhaps I'll start it a little bit later if viewership is going to be coming later. But if you missed any of the earlier breakdowns of Terunofuji's matches, you can catch it on my YouTube channel, where I will be posting the VOD of this stream. And, well, that's not going to be it for me, but it's going to be it for the breakdown part of the video. We've been, 10 p.m. Central Standard Time. So, like I mentioned, my streams will be happening at 10 p.m. Central Standard Time. You can catch the schedule on my Twitch. You can catch the schedule, on my Twitch. If you scroll down, you can see in my panels that I will be streaming then. Or you can catch this tweet where I talk about my schedule. On Thursday, we will be doing the sumo breakdown for Takakeisho. And on Friday, we will be talking about Abi. Next week, we'll be taking a few of the other guys, such as Uda and Takanosho, who are special prize winners, as well as some other fan favorites that may have done very well this tournament. So if you're watching this on YouTube, leave your favorite guy in the comments down below, and I might cover him. I'll definitely be covering Endo, so don't worry about him. And, well, if anyone has any other suggestions... Atlas, thank you for the subscription. This is the real fake Leo. Yeah, man. You know it. But again, if anyone has anything else, this is the end of the sumo portion of today's stream. And now we're just going to transition into just chatting. So give me un momento to switch over my screens.